Da fortsetter jeg med å filme han Rick Joyner. Fra Rick Joyners YouTube, hvor han snakker om Touch Not My Anointed.
Tares get sown in with the wheat in our individual lives as well as in movements and churches. The Lord's wisdom was let them grow up together. You'll be able to recognize them in their maturity. You don't want to try to root out the tares because until they mature, you can't really tell them apart. Many of the people that would definitely be branded as tares when they're young have emerged as some of the great voices, the most integrous and powerful voices. And they do have a track record of doing some dumb things in their past.
Rick Joyner, han prøver å bortforklare en del ting som har skjedd opp gjennom tida, blant annet det her med at han har dekket over Todd Bentley. Todd Bentley skilte seg jo fra kona etter Lakeland-vekkelsen, og det var jo katastrofe i og med at Rick Joyner var en av de som profeterte over han og ba for han og innsatte han som en av nar-apostlene. Så Rick Joyner og Bill Johnson og det var mange flere, og Peter Wagner, de innsatte da han Todd Bentley, og så endte det med at han skilte seg og gifte seg med barnepiken. Og han var også ruset under hele denne Lakeland-vekkelsen. Men det her da prøver han å bortforklare på en måte, med at det er ikke så nøye, vi må bare godta. Vi må godta tull og tøys, det er egentlig det han sier. Vi må godta at de har en del falsk lære og sånn, det er ikke så farlig.
As most of the great heroes of faith in Scripture do. Well, Jack Coe had the biggest tent at the time in the healing revival, according to this friend of mine, and he packed it out every night. It was just, he was probably the top of the pile of that movement at the time as far as crowd drawing and everything else. He came to his service one night and the tent wasn't full. And he asked, he says, where are all the people? Why aren't we full tonight? And they said, well, there's a woman in town who's drawn a big crowd herself. She's an evangelist. It turned out to be Catherine Kuhlman. And he was so upset by it, he called her a witch in his meeting. Well, here's one of the greatest, most powerful ministries at the time who was dead within 6 weeks of doing that. I think the Lord took him home to spare him. Once you start down that track, Lord said it'd be better to be born than to become a stumbling block.
Ja, du hørte her hva han forklarte hans død med. Denne mannen som kalte Catherine Kuhlman for en heks. Hans forklaring, da, Rick Joyner sin forklaring på at han døde 6 uker etterpå, det er da at han kalte henne for en heks. Så Rick Joyner, han mener da at Gud drepte den mannen. Så skal vi høre videre. Her sier han det samme om Catherine Kuhlman.
He said it'd be better not to be born than to become a stumbling block. That's one of the worst things we could ever be. And when we just react to people and react to stuff and overshoot, we could say they're wrong, they're immature, that's wrong, whatever. And we need challenges on that. We need to be able to deal with that. But to call them a false prophet, I think you're treading on really dangerous ground. Now, it so happened that Catherine Kuhlman became one of the great ministries, drawing huge crowds everywhere, having a major impact, major following. And she wanted to hire another friend of mine to be her teacher to do teaching to the crowds during the daytime before her ministry at night. And he prayed about it. He was really honored and everything, but he just said, I don't think I'm supposed to do that. And, she really reacted to his rejection of that and ended up calling him a false teacher. And she was gone within 6 weeks, dead. And I'm not saying I don't think either of them lost their salvation or whatever, but I think there are lines you cross, the things that you can get away with in the outer court, the things you can get away with in your immaturity, can get you killed later on. You know, and some of the people we've helped who had problems that needed to go through a process of restoration, I marked those who went public denouncing that person, saying terrible things about them. They're all gone now, or they themselves are divorced. Check it out. I'm not going to name their names or anything. I don't believe in doing that. Once they're gone, the Lord's disciplined them. They're his people. They're his servants, not mine, but...
Ja, det han sier er at han påstår at alle som har da sagt noe imot forskjellige folk, irettesatt læren som falsk og sånne ting, at de har det skjedd noe gærent med. Men hvis vi tenker etter, så er jo, hvordan var det han her, altså Peter Wagner er jo død, det er veldig mange av de her store forkynnerne som også er døde. Så det at folk dør etter at de har sagt noe, det betyr ikke at det er Gud som straffer dem, at det er Gud som dreper dem. Katrin Kullmann døde jo av kreft, ettersom jeg har forstått. Hun ble jo syk og døde av kreft. Så det er jo helt søkt å si at det var Gud som, det han sier her, det er at Gud som drepte Katrin Kullmann, fordi hun sa det. Og så er det han her Branham, William Branham. Han døde jo i en bilulykke. Hva skal vi si om det da, hvis vi skal begynne å tenke sånn? Liksom, var det Gud som drepte William Branham? Det er veldig mange av de her andre også som døde, og det har skjedd forskjellige ting med dem. Men Gud er ikke sånn. Den Guden som jeg tror på, er ikke sånn at han dreper folk fordi de sier noe til den og den tida, liksom. Men Bibelen oppfordrer oss til å irettesette vranglære. Og det gjorde også David imot han her, Saul, som jeg har vært inne på i den forrige videoen. Så nå kan vi høre hva han Benny Hinn sier.
I want to talk to you about something really important.
Benny Hinn blir den gammel mann som du ser. Og han har sagt det samme helt fra han var ung, touched not my anointed. Fordi han vil ikke ha noe kritikk. Han vil bare holde på sånn som han gjør, uten at noen skal få lov til å granske hans lære. Det som har skjedd er at Benny Hinn har tjent seg styrtrik på sin tjeneste. Han får folk til å sende penger til han som såkorn og som tiende, og de skal betale for å få frelse og helbredelse, rett og slett.
And this is something that I heard Catherine Kuhlman say years ago. And, you know, when I was young, I didn't think I understood it so well. She said, never touch anyone God is using. And she did a fabulous teaching. And later, when I became a pastor, I myself did my own research in the Bible on the danger of speaking against any individual God is using, whether they are pastors, evangelists, teachers of the Bible, or anyone God is using, period. And I really want to talk to you because I believe it's time we understand the scriptures. I'm not talking because it's, you know, about me or anyone else.
Ja, som du hører så står Benny Hinn fortsatt for det samme da. Touch not my anointed. Men han har en nevø som har gått ut og sier at han har gått ut og irettesatt onkelen sin. Han heter Kosti Hinn. Og han sier at han ble frelst ut av trosbevegelsen. Han møtte Jesus, og han ble frelst når han fikk vite sannheten som står i Guds ord, om det med penger og blant annet det her touch not the anointed one. Så han avslører trosbevegelsen som en som grådige. De som forkynner inn i trosbevegelsen, det er grådige predikanter som gjør seg rik på bekostning av fattige og syke mennesker. Du kan søke opp Kosti Hinn, så finner du mye av han på internett nå. Han har skrevet en bok som heter Defining Deception, blant annet. Så skal vi se litt på han her, Francis Chan. Francis Chan, här står det med stor bokstav. God might kill you if you criticize church leaders. Gud kan dräpa dig hvis du kritiserar någon ledare. Han har en hel massa märkliga ting han kommer med. För exempel att Gud sa till Israel att de inte skulle tala emot Guds tempel i det gamla testamentet. Och han menar att i det nya testamentet så är folk Guds tempel. Vi må därför aldrig tala emot Guds tempel, hans folk. Rick Warren, säger han, och Mike Bickle och Mark Driscoll är men of God. Är men av Guds män som aldrig må bli kritiserat. För Francis Chan känner dem personligt och de har goda hjärtar. Därför så ska vi aldrig kritisera dem. Hvis du taler mot disse Guds menn, så vil ikke Chan bli overrasket om Gud tar livet ditt. Fordi det var det han lovte i det gamle testamentet. Jeg vet ikke om jeg finner akkurat det stedet hvor han sier det i den filmen her, men skal prøve.
But here's some things the Lord's been teaching me lately about unity. And with that, man, you know what's amazing is even tonight, this morning, John, the pastor of Bethel, you know, upstairs. First time you read the story of Moses. And remember when Moses struck the rock? And God says, speak to the rock. And Moses struck it. The sacrifices before they go to war. And Samuel is late. Okay, he was beyond the 7 days that he was supposed to wait for him. And so Saul thinks to himself, well, I don't want to go to war without the sacrifices being offered, and Samuel didn't show up. So he's kind of stuck, like, do I just go to war? No, I want the blessing of God. So he says to the people, you know what? I'm going to go in and I'm going to offer the sacrifices because I don't want to go to war without God's blessing. We need to make the offering. Trim down. The branches that bore no fruit were actually sucking all the sexuality. God doesn't. Did God really say he would destroy you? You're seriously going to go after. That's why if you come from another church, man, don't go telling me anything about what happened over there and how they mistreated you and, oh, you poor victim. Man, I'm sorry, whatever, but you know what? Let's be very careful about our words. That's why people don't come to me with that stuff. You know, people boast like, oh, I'm a safe place. No, you're an enabler. You're an unloving enabler. You might as well put your hand on the sledgehammer with them. So, yeah, I can't believe that. Yeah, I can't believe that person. You are insane. Instead, if you love the person, you're like, dude, put that down. Don't let those words come out of your mouth. Look at what God says. And don't let Satan get in your head going, did God really say? Did God really say he would destroy you? And I mean, is that really his temple? Read it. I'm a part of the temple of God. Man, let's be careful with our words. Man, I hear people criticize leaders around our nation. And I haven't been quick to confront it, but now it's like, I'm getting serious. Like, are you crazy? Are you going to bash Rick Warren? This is a guy that loves the Lord. Yeah, you may not agree with everything he does, but man, I'm telling you, he loves Jesus. Everything I can tell, a supernaturally spirit-filled man. Are you going to attack Mark Driscoll? Are you going to attack John Piper? Are you going to attack Mike Bickle? Are you going to attack some of these expressions in the body of Christ that may look a little... I'm just saying, dude, put that down. I've met these people and I see their hearts and I hang out with people from these different denominations. I'm like, man, they love Jesus. It looks different from me, but I can see the Spirit in them. So we better be careful. And I'm reading this and I'm thinking, God, how come more people aren't dead? Seriously, I seriously prayed that. I go, God, I don't get it. You should have struck me dead. And here's what I heard from the Lord. They haven't been warned. The church hasn't warned people. We listen to gossip. We listen to people talk about leadership. And we don't warn them. We just kind of think that we're being loving by listening.
Ja, her fikk vi da høre Francis litt fra han, Francis Chan. Han vrir også på det her ordet om Samuel og Saul. At man ikke skal legge hånd på, eller man skal ikke si noe imot folk. Man skal ikke ta opp læren. Det er altså det motsatte av det som står i Bibelen. Så Paulus sa at vi måtte granske læren. Han hadde veldig masse advarsler imot falske lærere, blant annet i Apostlenes gjerninger 17:11.